Yeah, g'day guys, welcome back once again to One Voice Christian Church YouTube channel. Our services online, it's good to be back with you guys again, good to be here. Always busy, busy in the world we live in, isn't it? So this morning, as we come to a time of worship, we'll kick off today's service with some worship. Just some things, as always, to ponder. So I was having a look at Chronicles. So I've got a scripture for you guys this morning. It's 1 Chronicles 16, verse 23, and it says, "Sing to the Lord, all the earth, proclaim his salvation day after day." What a wonderful opportunity that we have, that we're not limited to just being, you know, singing in a church or singing online. We can be worshipping in the car, we can worship in the office, we can worship pretty much anywhere. When we're walking, you know, just whack on some Christian music and away we go. But for us this morning, it's an opportunity to come together as a family, as a body of Christ. And it doesn't matter where you are, wherever you're watching this, it doesn't matter what country you're in, doesn't matter what state of Australia you're in, no matter where you are, we can come together and we can worship our God. And it's said there in 1 Chronicles 16, verse 23, to sing day after day. So this morning, we've got some songs prepared for you guys. So what an opportunity to praise his name. And I think as we come around, you know, a time of just praising him, let's lift our hands, let's be joyful. And let's sing some praises to him through the songs that we've prepared to you guys. And the Bible says that he loves to hear our praises. So let's praise him this morning. Lift your hands, you know, lift your hearts, lift your voices. And let's praise our God. And I'll be back at the end of worship with the next part of today's service online. So enjoy the worship and I'll see you again shortly.
So aimless, life filled with sin, I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Covered me. I had no idea where the way out could be. Then came the sunrise and rolled back the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Just like a blind man, I wandered alone. Worries and fears I claim for my own. Then like a blind man, God gave back his sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Go! Sound on that eternal shore. When I join with the angels in heaven on high, singing praise, Lord, he is alive.
Sad. Heal. Earth has no sorrow, heaven
So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. Oh, I'm broken. Lift up your face. Oh, wanderer, come home. You're not too far. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you are. There's hope for the hopeless and all those who've strayed. Come sit at the table, come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary, rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't cure. So lay down your sinner, be still. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame.
Forgiven, child, there is freedom.
things I wish I hadn't done. I've seen things I wish I hadn't seen. Just the thought of your amazing grace, and I cried, Jesus, forgive me. God, I fall down to my knees with a hammer in my hand. You look at me, arms open. Forgiven, forgiven. Child, there is freedom from all of it. Say goodbye to every sin. You are forgiven. I could have been 6 feet under. I could have been lost forever. Yeah, I should be in that fire, but now there's fire inside of me. Here I am, a dead man walking. No grave gonna hold God's people. All the weight of all our evil lifted away, forever free. Who could believe? Who could believe? Forgiven, forgiven. You love me even when I don't deserve it. Forgiven, I'm forgiven. Jesus, your blood makes me innocent. So I will say goodbye to every sin. I am forgiven.
Yeah, welcome back again. Pray you guys enjoyed the worship this morning, the songs that we've had prepared for you, and really just believing that you guys were able to really engage in praising him this morning and just letting go and being able to, you know, just to sing to our Lord. So we're going to come to a time of communion. So once again, you guys that have been following us online, you know the process. So get yourselves a cup, get yourselves a bread, biscuit, juice. You know, we're going to participate in communion. One of the most important things, I think, in our Christian faith is to remember what he's done, to actually be mindful that he said, do this in remembrance of me. So today, we're in for a treat. We're in for a blessing. Han Lee Van Staden, very good friend of mine, very good friend, passionate lady about the Lord, very passionate is a good word for her. She's going to be leading us around the communion table. So have a pen and paper ready if you want to have a look for yourself what she shares this morning. But it's about remembering. So Han Lee will bring us around the table. Like I said, have your juice, have your cup ready. Following Han Lee, I'll be back with today's message. So once again, if you've got pen and paper, one of the things I want to encourage everybody to do, I've said this many times and I'll continue to say it, and that is have a look at the scriptures that are presented and then go and have a look for yourself. See what God's got for you. See what manner he's got for you in the scriptures and what he wants to show you in his word. It is a living word, as we all know. So even with communion this morning, you know, go away and have a look at what she shared and then have a look for yourself what God wants you to see in remembering him. So have your juice ready, have your cup ready, and Han Lee will be here now to share the communion message, and I'll see you after the communion message. Bless you guys and see you next week. Bless you guys.
Yes.
Hello?
Yes!
Good morning, everyone. The first thing I want to do, I want to
say congratulations to Pastor Bethany. And you know, I was thinking what can I say? I want to say to you every blessing that I'm currently aware of and the ones that I'm not aware of, that I'm still discovering, because there's so many. So congratulations for you and your family. And I mean that from my heart. The second thing is a testimony, Pastor, right? Don't count it as part of my time, but it is really wonderful. So we landed in South Africa on the Wednesday afternoon, And Andrew will know it's a bit jet laggy, you know, whatever. And on Saturday morning, I went with Kubis and my daughter and a friend on a park run. They call it a park run. It was very hot. Long story short, only 5 kilometers. And I wanted to catch up with them because they were in front of me. And in the shadow, you see that stripe in Maryland? there was a shady area. It's out in the veld, right? Beautiful area, next to a big dam, etc. And it was shaded by bushes and trees and stuff. And I ran fast. And I tripped over a tree root, and I fell on this elbow. So I fractured it there and there, and obviously all the ligaments and the whatever. So then I had to walk. I walked 2 kilometers with my arm like this, and when I got to the end, I was covered in dust and blood because there were thorns everywhere, right? I fell into a thorn bush as well. Long story short, obviously they took me to the emergency department, the one that Sarani is managing. And you know, when I got in there, I sat down, they took my blood pressure. It was low. People said I fell my blood pressure low because usually when I see a doctor, it goes up. When I see a whatever, it goes up. But here's the story. A nurse came in. And they took blood, you know, for my whatever, I don't even know what. And she said, don't worry, God's grace is enough for you. Beautiful black lady with white as white teeth. You know the people from Africa are white teeth. Okay, Father. Long story short, I was in there for some time, took x-rays, etc. Sarani found one of the orthopedic surgeons. He came, 32-year-old, he looked at the x-rays, called us, I was like, this is a serious injury, etc., etc. But that lady came and she spoke to me 3 times, right? 3 times. And I looked at her. Everything she said is what I believe. And I just said, you know what, you're shining. You're shining. So for me, she's one of the shining ones. And guys, I took her name and Kubis took her name and telephone number, and I bought a gift which Sarani gave to her, and she sent me a photo. And you know, I just know it was a heart connection. God has provided for me. He's even provided, I took my castor oil and my cayenne pepper and I put it on my arm. We saw an orthopedic surgeon here Thursday. And he said, good news, good news, good news. Don't need an operation. All it needs is, you know, needs to heal. And he was very surprised with the movement in my arm. Also, that young orthopedic surgeon in South Africa was right. Don't put it in a sling. Don't put it in a cast because my elbow will become stiff. So praise God for that. But there in South, oh, what's that? I've got a check here. And I'm keeping it. Because I discovered later on there's still a thorn here, sitting a thorn, you know, we haven't got rid of this thorn yet, but I'm keeping it, so I'm jokingly saying, I've got a chip now. They said the South African president got a chip. Okay, I don't know what that means, but I've got a chip and I'm just carrying it. So, beautiful people, I think what struck me the most in South Africa was to see exactly what I'm been working on. And that is the kingdom of God, which is in us, which is righteousness, peace, and joy. And every time I have a choice to yield my emotions, my past experiences, my intellect, my senses, I can go with that. There's nothing wrong with it. God gave it to us, right? You can call it our flesh. But I have a choice to yield that to Christ in me. Some people call it the Christ mind. Some people call it dominion. It's dominion in us. Right? Now I come a long way with this. Because we started a school called Basileia, which means Kingdom of God. But it was so clear for me in South Africa. And it was wonderful because there's a lot of people who are doing exactly that. Even though they don't even know it. And when we do that, the kingdom from heaven comes and can be established every single time. Now what happened here in Australia while we were away, we very significant thing, in my view. A lady called Nancy Cohen and Justin Paul Abraham, they came and they visited Australia. Now, I know Nancy Cohen from way, way back. She ministered, for example, to headhunters. They came for her in Africa. They came for her. They wanted to behead her. And then I had to stop in front of her. Why? She heard from the Lord. Jesus only did what he heard his father is telling him to do, etc. She heard from the Lord. At that stage, she was not supposed to go onto social media and whatever, but some way, somehow, someone got a tape from her. And then they had an encounter with the love of the Father. She ministered to many, many Muslim men. They still call her today. I think you will know that that's not what men, Muslim men does. Women can't minister to them. Why? Because she had an encounter, many encounters, with the love of the Father, and he sent her. And they have experienced it. I was very blessed there, Pastor Red. One of our friends, he is a Dutch Reformed Dominie, Reverend. He has retired, beautiful man. And I tested him, and I said, you know, Johan, I believe Christ is in all. I said, I believe the same. Dutch Reformed Church. But how can it be? How else can it be? We are his offspring. It says there, I've read it to you. You read it yourself in Acts 17. From one man he made all. From one blood. And then it says, indeed, we are his offspring. In him we live and move and have our being. If he takes our breath away, we're not here anymore. The breath of God is in every person. So interesting, this man who's going to do a PhD in the Old Testament now says, honey, I tend to agree with you. So now what do I want to say this morning? I want to say to you, what Nancy Cohen came and she ministered here, in Mildura, so by the way, it's nothing short of a miracle. She came to Mildura and then they went back. It's about the dominion of Christ. The dominion of God. Now we say I've said that to you. The same, you know it better, you know it. The same power that's in me. You know, that same power rising from the dead. That's what the word says, right? That's what it says. Okay. Now where is it? I've asked many times about South Africa. I know that I am still meant to be there, even if it's just in the spirit. I know. I can't just cut that off, right? I know that. I know in the order of Melchizedek, which I don't always understand, but a little bit of that, I can't just let go. In any case, how is it possible? They all believe, nearly everyone. They have these amazing prayer meetings. How is it possible that things are still out of order, to say it lightly? I just saw a little clip from Nancy while she was ministering here. She said the following. We've moved out of the age of the church into the kingdom age. I know that. Don't worry. She said it as well. The church isn't coming to an end. The church will continue. But out of the church age into the kingdom age, the kingdom of God. Right? But this thing about dominion, he couldn't trust us with that prior. Because if we could use this full power which was available to each one of us, and we were still sitting with issues, hard issues, we would have, I'll send that clip to you, Pastor Ray, because it hit me big time. We would have destroyed the earth several times. Why? Because when we operate out of our own issues, and we don't, you became one. The same thing, that marriage, the union between the female and the male, when we get that right, you will see things will change in you, around you, and furthermore. So my goal is the following. Father, start with me. Yes, my heart. Show me. Let the cross deal with my heart issues. Every single one. And if not, he's the most loving Father. He will never hurt you. He will never condemn you. That has been dealt with. We sang about forgiven. We were forgiven before the beginning of time. Read the word. When that happened, I wouldn't have to say a word, but things around me will change. We are one. But we're not walking in that oneness perhaps yet. I told Quibus before we left, it was, you know, we have so much stuff that we need to do. Later on, the Father, can you just stay 3 weeks? Can you just stay in peace? And I told him, you know, and then we become, you know, snappy or whatever you call that, you know, we bite each other. You know what? We're in the kingdom, we're out of the kingdom. We're in the kingdom, we're out of the kingdom. That's what we do. Because then I'm in the flesh, you know, then, oh, Father, sorry. And, you know, that's what we do. Now, think about that on a broader scale. Then, this is personal, but I'm going to use it. Our daughter in South Africa, I've never, ever heard her say anything negative about South Africa. Never. There's a lot of corruption. There's a lot of people don't care about their own people. But never. That spoke to me. Big time. So whatever is going on in this country, if I want that dominion, God. Heart? Because we create with our thoughts, guys. Never mind our words. We know we create with our words. But our hearts. So today, I don't know what it is, but I can tell you, I know there's stuff in my heart that the cross can deal with. And how does he deal with this stuff? We actually sang about it, lay it down. Another way is just release it. And now I hope you're not going to take this. I'm going to be very, very sort of crude here, but it's so practical. I'll never forget this, Father. You know, what happens to our bodies when we need to go to the toilet? Something needs to come out, right? That's a wonderful thing. Praise God for that. The same thing when we sit with emotions that makes us feel uncomfortable. It's our body telling us this thing must go. Just release it. Not a big deal. I can relate to this. I can remember this. This thing makes me uncomfortable. You know, I have this feeling about Pastor Ed, which I don't. You know, I don't like him really, you know, this area or whatever. Just let it go. Just acknowledge it and let it go. Just acknowledge it and let it go, so that we truly can operate in this oneness. Now, our daughter gave me a diary, one of her diaries, and she printed hundreds, guys, because she's got three companies there. And this spoke to me so much, so, so much. On the front of the diary, if I can remember correctly now, it says, we are people of value. We are people of value. You need to love yourself. I need to love myself. We are people of value. It starts there where I sit with him, where I look in his eyes, and I know who I am. I'm secure in who I am. Then it says, we are people of value who value people. Doesn't matter who they are. Doesn't matter whether it's the greatest murderer in South Africa. We value people. And add value to them. That's what I said, Sarani, this is going to minister to so many people. We are people of value. Who value people and add value to them. Guys, I think this is in a business context, of course. But if we can do this, we can change a lot in the world. And I know you are doing that already. I know that. It challenged me, You know, little things that rise up in me, okay, Father. This thing, I want His dominion. And perhaps, you know, a beautiful thing this morning, Pastor Red, I showed him that I was supposed to do communion on the 10th of December. It's on my phone. But it's not about you are wrong and I'm right. No. That stuff should just go. It's not about that. And perhaps I'll continue on the 10th of December if I still have to go ahead with that. As the Lord is working this out in me, because it is a working out thing. But remember, this dominion thing is not for everyone, because we would have destroyed the earth many times. I stood here in front of you several times, and I said, I look at the TV and I don't like what these people are telling us. I wish I could just punch them. Man, I wish I could wipe them from the earth. No, that's not the way to do it. Right? So that's all I wanted to say, Pastor Red. If there's something wrong that I've said, it's jet lag. I can't blame jet lag. So if you could please hand out those elements. So by the way, when it comes to communion, it's not just a one-off. We are in union with Him every single second of the day and night. Walk in that consciousness. Yes, we're going to eat and drink here to remember. There is absolutely no condemnation. If I have to deal with something, deal with it. So that you can walk free. And so that we can start walking in this dominion, which will change the earth, right? Thank you. Father, I just want to pray and to breathe with my brothers and sisters. Every breath that we take, we breathe you in and we breathe you out. And I'm so thankful for every breath. Father, sometimes we don't know what to do. When we look at the world, the situation in our own lives, we can just breathe. The breath of God. With intent. And life will come into dead bones. So Father, over this country, Australia, and the country South Africa that I'm carrying the chip, I just thank you for the people who are start walking in that dominion. And that dominion, your rule and reign, your royal rule and reign in and throughout will never hurt people, but will cause people to understand who they really are. I thank and I honor you for that. And what a privilege to stand with my brothers and sisters today and say, this is your flesh. We take it now. Just to remind us. We eat together. Thank you for what you did on that cross. A lot of trauma happened to you. But it was all about what you've done with that. You said, forgive them. Because I don't know what they're doing. Thank you. And once again, Father, we know that life is in the blood. And this group of people here today, I take hands with them. And I thank you that your blood, we are your offspring. We are your offspring. From one blood, you made all. And I pray that your spirit will minister to each one of us. Uniquely, individually. I cannot thank you enough for this privilege. I cannot thank you enough for the cross, the fact that you're not on that cross anymore, that you are risen, for your spirit in us now. And together with millions of brothers and sisters who already know this, we take hands across the globe and we say thank you. We honor you. We love you. And thank you. Every time when we focus on you, you add value to us. It's there already, but we become aware of it. Amen.
Matthew chapter 7, and we'll get to the scriptures in a minute. Hanley, I swear you read all my notes. Praise God, Hanley. You didn't know you were doing communion this morning, so. We'd Neville, yes. And unfortunately, Neville's not able to be here today due to her having some medical procedure. So we're both. Hey, no worries, Neville. We're both all right. How cool is that? For a change, I'm actually right on stuff. A great message. So the message this morning is basically a continuation from Hanley's communion, if you were taking notice. However, we're going to have a chat about the speck in your brother's eye. So that's what we're talking about today. We're going to start at the start of Matthew chapter 7 verse 1. Opening remarks. Can we put up verse 1 please, Ellen?
I haven't got
it
yet.
Didn't we put it in there? Didn't we? I did not. That's the idea. Did you hear that one, Hartley? Janelle said because you've got jet lag, I'm back from honeymoon, so there you go, that's good news. Sally, I don't know how hard it is for you to put in Matthew chapter 7, verse 1 to 5. She's on it. All right, who's got verse 1 on hand? Can somebody read it out loud, please? Nice and loud.
Stop judging so that you won't be judged.
All right. There's an opening remark. Now remember, we're talking about speck of dust and plank of wood. We'll get to that in a minute. What an opening remark from Jesus who goes on to say, and what was it again, Andrew? Stop judging. Oh, we've got it. Do not judge and criticize and condemn others unfairly with an attitude of self-righteous superiority, as though assuming the office of a judge, so that you will not be judged. Interesting, one of the things that's led about this particular topic coming up, and one that I found a very entertaining, if not annoying, journey with God, myself, on this topic. Very annoying. Because when you prepare to speak and to share with people on what God's talking about. It's funny how he wants to do a cross-examination of the one speaking. Isn't that right, Tony? I know you'd be on the end of that. Having a look at the world that I live in and having a look at the... You know, I'm not going to get political, but all you've got to do is have a look at Palestine and Israel right now. And I'm looking at the people that live in our country and I'm saddened to see people that flee war zones, flee places of strife just to come here and instead of embracing, I understand that you're talking about loved ones and home, but then to start doing crazy stuff here in a country that they've escaped from, like in a country that they've got away from their mess to come to here. Fascinated am I about the commentary still going on about a voice referendum that was how long ago? And still going on. Fascinated am I about people on Facebook who have an opinion on a cricket team and you would have think you've just let off a nuclear bomb somewhere. Fascinated am I when I have a listen to people around me, Christian and non-Christian alike, finding specks of dust in other people's lives, but failing miserably, I might add. And by the way, before this comes across as condemning or hard, bear in mind that as I speak to you, I'm going to share openly what God's doing with me, because when I said to him about, yep, the plank of wood, he said to me, I had an old ship in there. Don't worry about a plank of wood. He said to me, I've created a boat. And when I asked him, what do you mean by a boat? He said, well, you certainly set the sail on a few things. That really spoke to me. Setting sail, in other words, I found comfort sitting in the boat with quite a few of the things that are not so pleasant inside of me. I like to think that I'm right all the time. Anybody else think like that? My opinions are just. Oh, am I finding out that I need a life raft real quick? Anyway, the first thing that I want to speak about is these glasses today. The first thing I want to speak about is when I look at this, it says in the first sentence, do not judge and criticize and condemn. So I started looking at, we did this a Bible study on Wednesday night, but in looking at that, we spoke about Jesus turning the tables over on the Wednesday night Bible study, and that scripture, I don't want to put up on the boards, but if you want to go and have a look, the scripture is Matthew 21, 12 to 13 is where he turns over tables. We had a look at, well, what's the difference between him turning a table over and judging people that were, you know, laundering money, if you like, for lack of a better word, compared to us turning the table over and exposing somebody's poor behaviour. So we actually spoke about that, and one of the things that we came back with was that the first point I want to make out of this is that Jesus didn't judge the individual, he judged the behaviour. When he turned the tables over, he knew full well that as soon as he was out of the building, they were going to put the tables back up and they were going to go back to doing it. So it wasn't for the people that were, you know, turning his father's house into a den of thieves. It was for the 12 disciples, I believe, is why the tables were turned over. Yes, he tried to tell them to stop behaving like this, but he wanted to show the 12 disciples that favoritism, you know, unbiasedness, or, you know, choosing one side over another, not just about finances, is not how we're supposed to live. So we're not supposed to judge people. You know, the Bible talks about don't just honour somebody who comes in with fancy gold and fancy clothes and lots of money and neglect the one that comes in, has come off the street. And I was so praying that that person from down the river would make it here today, because I'd like to honour him just as much as we'd like to honour anybody else that comes in this place. And again, back to judgment, because it's easy to judge people by appearances, it's easy to do all of that. In saying that, in not judging the individual was still part of what was going on. I believe, in my heart, when we judge behaviour, there's a fine line between judging the individual as well. It's a very fine line. Jesus said, love the person, hate the sin. In being able to hate people's sin and love the person, well, I thought I was doing all right at that until God showed me I built a ship. And then I realised how quickly lines can blur between opinions and facts. How quickly lines can blur between what I think and what somebody else thinks. So Andrew and I could have a totally different point of view on a cricket team. Andrew probably couldn't care less. But I'm positive Andrew and I would have a very much a different point of view on a musical instrument, because I couldn't care less. See my point? So we're going to have a look at a few things here in this story. So I'm going to read down. Next one, please, Sally. I'll read down, then we'll come back and have a look at it. For just as you hypocritically judge others when you are sinful and unrepentant, so will you be judged, and in accordance with your standard of measure used to pass out judgment. Judgment will be measured to you. We'll go right through to five, thank you, Sally. Why do you look at the insignificant speck that is in your brother's eye, but do not notice and acknowledge the egregious log that is in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, let me get the speck out of your eye, when there is a log in your own eye? You hypocrite. Play act the pretender. First get the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly that they have stepped out of your brother's eye. That was the last one, wasn't it, Sally?
Oh, then we gotta
be one more. Can we do one more? You want to do one more? We'll do one more. Do not give that which is holy to dogs, and do not throw your pearls before pigs, for they will trample them under their feet and turn and tear you to pieces. Okay. You can take it back to verse 2, Sally. We'll go through it. when I was looking at the behaviour in the individual, the first thing that really stood out that separates my behaviour from me being an individual is if Christ didn't die for me, then my behaviour tends to become the person I am. You ever notice that? People tend to give out what they've had come in. So when I stopped and looked at that, I went, well, Jesus, you died for me. Well, don't leave them on, but I do this way. You died for my judgment. I had to stop and think about that for a minute. How many of you know that he died for your judgment? Every Christian on the planet has to remember, when we broke bread this morning, aren't we so brilliantly done? So brilliantly done. He died for my judgment. Not just my sin. And I'm going to separate him. He died for the judgment that was rightfully on my life. And that is, without Christ, what do I have? I deserve death. I deserve the wages of my sin. Is there anybody else in the room that understands that? That's the first thing he reminded me of when I was looking at this, because he's gone a bit deep with me on this one, so I'll try not to bury his all in the craziness of what he's done with me. But the number one thing he said, the moment you start judging and continue to judge and make a habit of judging is when you've forgotten first love. Because if you remember why he died for you, very hard to judge somebody else. Because we may feel that our sin is only this big. But can I tell you that the judgment that is rightfully yours without him lasts eternal. That's what he reminded me this morning. This particular point I got this morning. And I'm like, oh, dude. You know, I felt not a sorrow, not a heaviness, but I felt I don't know how to explain the weight that I felt this morning. And it was almost like, imagine how much weight his body felt on him when he was hanging on a cross the way they hung him. You know, just being held there by your hands with nails in them. I wonder what the weight would have been on his hand. Just on his hands. Where only a nail's holding him up, and the more he moves, the more that nail makes the hole bigger. I don't know, that'd be gruesome for some of you. But this morning, this is what he was talking to me about. He could have hopped off that cross at any time. I can hop off my judgment cross any time. Because he first did. He stayed there because he knew that he had to so that I could get off. That's a swapping of positions, isn't it? He had to stay on there to make it so that I could get off it. I could get off my judgmental high horse. I want you to write this down. Do you remember your first love? And what he did, what he said, and what he died for? For the forgiveness of sins is what he said. So that I could be reinstated with my Father, so that my Father could live with me, so that I could have eternal life, so that there'd be a mansion. Do you want me to keep going? That's why he died for me. He never said he died for me so he could judge, so I could judge everybody else. So if that's the case, and you remember your first love, it's got to be more difficult to judge people now. Because if he did all of this, and Tyson did that much, and I'm going to hold on to that much, oh, and there's going to be people in the world that are instantly going to arc up inside, and they're going to go, you don't understand. I'm going to say to them, not my problem. Do you understand? And they're going to go, Red, but you don't understand. I've been raped. I've been beaten. I've been this. I've been that. And I'm going to say to you and to those watching, do you think anybody in here is an orphan to you? I want to show you something real quickly, if I may. Two simple things. Cheryl's a sister to me. To a person who's been violated in whatever form, try being racist in the way she's had to deal with it. So we can't compare, and neither should we. All of us have to reach down deep inside to be able to forgive. All of us have to reach down deep inside and fight to not judge. All of us have to reach down deep inside and remember what Christ did for us. That is a fact. I don't care who you are, I don't care where you're from, what colour, what age, what background, what financial position, all of us are the same. Do you know how I know that? Because in the garden, my Lord and Saviour had blood coming out of his head. because the weight of me on him, the weight of me on that cross must have been excruciating. But then I understand the weight he placed on me when he came out of the tomb. Oh, that tomb is bouncing around in my head again. Bouncing around in my head again. Did he bring me out of the tomb, or am I still hitchhiking to the galaxy in there? Am I out of that tomb, or am I still living in the death of it? Am I free, or am I still bound? Here's where we go. This is where God's talking to me. If you're still judging, you're not free. If you're still being offended by things or by people, you're still not free. Oh, does that mean we're going to work perfectly? No, because we should be able to tell the difference, just like Christ did, between the individual and the behavior. I don't have to agree with the behavior of people. That's not my problem, but I must love them. There's the simple truth. And I'm like, Lord, can we rewind back a little bit? Like, can we debate a few points on this? Like, if you think this is easy for me, it's not. Because the line between behavior and individual gets blurred very quickly. Is there anybody else in the room that understands that? Person's behavior, you can see a person's behavior and actually attack them instead of disagreeing with the behavior. How do you tell a person that says, I'm a sinner, and they start crying because they realize the weight of their sin, if you're going to go, yeah, that's right, you are a sinner? Or are you going to say to them that your sins were paid on the cross, receive Jesus Christ and get set free from them? You're going to have to get your eyes off the sin to be able to do that. Because the sin in this world right now, my God, you know how many keyboard warriors we've got on the planet at the moment? You know where I came from? You spoke like that, your head knocked off. And yet these keyboard warriors are going hammer and tongue, and yet then I look at somewhere else and they're all full of anxiety, they're all full of fear, they're all alone, they're all ostracized, and I'm like, how's that going for you? While you're busy threatening the whole world and attacking everybody, how's your life going? Okay, so let's have a look at some points. Okay, number one, if you're taking notes, I want you to write your standard and measure. Standard and measure. Every one of us has a different standard and measure. So the first word next one I want you to write is value. Your standard and measure will depend on your value. Your ability to forgive will depend on your value. Your ability to be able to see one thing greater than another will be dependent on what you value something. I will break that down a little bit. Let's start with the first one, the most obvious, right? Past experiences. I'm going to use a simple example because I think it's the easiest way for me to explain it. And hopefully to those of you in the room and those of you on YouTube, you'll be able to identify it into your own value system. But I'll use a simple one that I think is relatively simple. All right. The first one. If you've been running around cheating since you've been growing up, you know, running around, sleeping with people on the side, having a girlfriend, go find somebody else to go sleep with, you're going to struggle with judgmental issues on a partner. Let me show you why. There'll be two types of judgment that's going to come out of you. The first one is, you're going to judge every move they make. You're going to become a control freak. Let me show you why. Because you were the one that was running around on the phone in the darkness trying to hide your phone from other people, trying to keep it away that nobody could see it. You were the one sneaking off with your silly little lies about I'm working too late, I'm going to go catch up with a girlfriend, or I'm going to go somewhere. You were the one that invested all of this into it, and now along comes a bloke that you're madly in love with, now you're panicking that he's going to do the same to you. Or flip it if you want. Simplest way to explain judgment. You're going to put on somebody else exactly what you've been through, past experience. Or you're going to have the other way. Only two ways with this. When I see people that have jealous issues, insecurities, spying on each other's phone, spying on each other's website, spying on where you're going, you know, where you go, tell me where you are. Now, in fact, I know a person who has a tracker on their husband. Well, if you think I'm joking, I am not. Has an actual tracker. I was with another person, so there's multiple people here. I was with another person, I was at a servo, and I stopped to say good day to them. At the servo, right? And all of a sudden, the wife's on the phone. How much did you just spend? I can see it on the bank account. I'm serious. I am serious. I freaked. I'll never forget it. He spent $17.48 and she knew it before he'd even walked out the shop. So whenever he uses his own money, there must be an alert or something that comes up. And if you think about the tracker, that's a serious one. Oh, and the pretense of, if you happen to get lost or something, I can find you. I have no tracker. Whatever, she can go wherever she wants, when she wants. But then there's something else. I'm going to flip the coin. Then there's the other side of the coin. This is a simple one for you. You can put it in whatever terms you want. You can put it in drug deals. You can put it in alcohol. You can put it in whatever you want. Then there's the other side. And that is the person that's had it done to them. And then they live in it. See, they had it done to them. You know, one of the things I said to Emma before we got married, for those of you that can remember, I said, we're not marrying straight away. We're waiting for a while because we're going to work through our luggage, because I'm not bringing my luggage in, because there's a problem when you've got two suitcases of luggage. Bad enough having one without bringing another one in you. Or metaphor. Is that the right word? Thank you. Imagine having to mow your own lawn and then having a 10-acre paddock to mow as well on the other side of the fence. Enough trouble mowing my own lawn without mowing somebody else's. So guess what happens to a person that's been unjustly dealt with or had this done to them? I refuse. Because I've made a point, and here's something I want to show you when it comes to judgment. Do not become the very thing you despise the most. Write that down. Do not become the very thing you despise the most. You don't like being controlled? Then don't become controlling. You don't like being spied on? Then don't spy on somebody. You don't like being put down in every conversation? Then don't put anybody else down. Do not become the thing you despise the most. Second one, worth. Your self-worth. Yeah, you're right. I'm a failure. Yeah, I'm right. I deserve what I'm getting. Your self-worth, well, that will dictate what your price, what your value is, and what the value of other people are. So you've got your own self-worth, and you've got the worth of others. See, what God's been reminding me is the self-worth I should have is Jesus died for me. That should be my self-worth. Shouldn't be. I should not be examining my worth by action of deeds or by wrongdoings. I should be examining my life through the eyes of Christ. And through the eyes of Christ, yes, I've got some stuff that I have to deal with. I'm not debating that. But mine should be identified, or mine should be through the way Christ sees me. Therefore, here's the challenge. Here's where my boat suddenly got a mast and a sail on it. I should be looking at others with the same eyes on what their value is to Christ. You notice my ship's only getting bigger. It's getting ready to set sail. And when I get going, mate, it needs an anchor to stop me from going. It's a good metaphor, isn't it, Tyson? The ship getting going. What about the plank? All right. What about levels? Here we go. Write this one down. Levels. Your judgment can have levels. But I'm going to show you what I mean by that. How many of you think lying is really bad? Stealing's really bad. Pedophilia. Rape. Domestic violence. What about backstabbing and gossiping? Or what about denying? All of us, don't care who you are, this is something God's pointing out to me, all of us have a level system. And you can all like it or lump it, what I'm about to say, I know this to be true. All of us, because of past experience or because of family trauma or because of whatever reason, we will have a level system where one thing is greater than another. I have a question for everybody in the room and on the camera. What sin did Christ say was the greatest? What one did he say was the least? Or did he just all say it was the same? Level playing field, whether you're a liar, whether you're a deceiver, whether you're a cheater, whether you're a fornicator, I don't know how many other things I can go through. Can I tell you, all fallen short of the glory of God. So when you look at the person that's around us and we see them, guess what? Don't judge, because you're judging yourself. You're better off saying, I don't agree with their behavior. But I think the verse is pretty cool because Christ died for them. How's that sound?
Yeah.
Simple wording. Wording now that because of this, now I can't hide in the back of the boat somewhere. Now I've got to deal with my stuff. And if you think I'm finding it easy, I'm not, because all of a sudden I'm going, oh my God, how many things I judge. And thinking they're righteous, but they're not, they're self-righteous. I want you to write this one down. Accusations. This one got hold of me. I know on Wednesday night at Bible study we talked about all of this we've talked about, but I'm just trying, God's just taking a whole new level with me. Accusations. The first one is done. You know when you say something's done, you're saying it's finished. I'm done. You're saying finished. I'm done with Joe Blog. I'm done with X, Y, and Z. Normally, we say what's done is because of what somebody has done to us or because of what we've done. Notice the word done. I wrote this down. I know I've already spoken on it, but I want you to look at the word done. Christ said, it is done.
Amen.
Interesting that we say, we're done, but Christ said, it's done. You're done. I hear people, I'm done with you. I'm not coming. Right? Yet Christ said, it's done. He died for us. It don't matter where we're from, it don't matter what we're doing, it don't matter what we've been through. It is done. May I ask you all? So the accusations, the first accusation I want to look at is what's accusing you. Because basically, we've been talking so far, whatever judgments are coming out of us is normally the judgments that's coming in us. You're normally judging by the same measure. That's what that said. Same measure of what's been done to you. What's the accusation against you that's leading you or tempting you or driving you to judge? Instead of accusation, why don't you write acquittal? Acquittal. Anybody know what acquittal means? Back to that word. Done. Can you believe that the judgments against you are false and baseless through Christ Jesus? Your past? Baseless. Because my Bible teaches me that he said that every sin you've ever committed, you have committed today, or you will ever commit, has come under his blood. Has come under his acquittal. People that understand legal matters, understand particularly those that have trouble with the police, particularly those that have those things, but understand when you're acquitted, you walk free and there is no more visiting lawyers, judges or prosecutors. You walk out of a building and you don't walk in again. That's what acquittal means. Some of us today have to walk out and walk in acquittal on some judgments that either we're holding or being done to us. The word acquittal. Acquitted. Is that a word? Oh, thank God for that. I'm just looking. Is that a word? Make words up while I'm going. And that's the same for those on YouTube. Are you acquitted? Or are you still standing in the dock? Waiting your turn. And by the way, I want to show you something. To the person that's not acquitted, to the person that holds on to things, that holds on to judgments, I want to show you what an outcome is. And I said it right at the start. You know, I was looking at a specific little keyboard warrior. Man, they can talk the game. Man, they can talk tough. Anybody think they'll melt twice as brother the way they talk? Only to find out that they're suffering in many ways. And I'll show you the one thing that they're suffering the most is loneliness. Write this down. Judgment brings loneliness. Is that going to tell you something? If you're going to constantly tell your wife she's ugly, how long before she's going to try and look beautiful for you? If you're going to constantly tell your wife she's a piece of garbage, how long before she wants to even be near you? If you're going to constantly tell your workmate he's a failure, if you're going to constantly tell somebody something, 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 what do you reckon the outcome's going to be? You're going to become alone. And you're going to isolate. Judgment's very good at isolating the person judging. Not necessarily the judge to. Let's keep moving. You know, when I looked at all of this, and to me I was looking at all of these things, you know, the standard we use, accusations, all of this stuff, and then I stopped and I went, well, how do we get out of it? How do you get out of it? What do you do on a constant basis? Because if you think it ain't constant, it is. Because this judgment has everything to do with a person's shoes, to a person's hair colour, to their skin, to where they work, to what they do, where they live. Judgment never ends. If you actually stop and think about it, even when you come in here, you're still judging. I'm sorry, but that's the brutal truth. This has really messed with my head, this particular topic. And by the way, now there's a bit of wind picking up and the sails have squiggled right out and now the boat's starting to move. Alright, the boat's starting to move and I'm thinking I'm going to have to submerge this boat, I'm going to have to sink it. Otherwise we're going to end up in fairyland. If we don't stop the boat from sailing, what do you think's coming? Judgment, you can start in an area that's legit. Alright? Yes, you did have this done. Yes, you did go through that. Yes, they did say this about you. But if you don't sink this boat, how long before she takes flight, and then it's so hard to pull it up? And I want to show you something. I start off in a little canoe, all right? By the time I've finished, I've built the Britannia, or the Titanic-sized wooden ship with that many guns on it. And by the way, there's many people jumping in with me. Do you know why? Because I'm not letting them out of the boat. Many people hopping in this boat, not because they're hopping in, because they want to be there. I'm putting them in this boat. Because I won't let them out. My boat's pretty full, like I've got a Titanic-sized passenger list. Anybody else got a passenger list? I have. Titanic hit an iceberg. I'm going to have to hit a Godberg on it. I'm going to have an encounter with the living God. I like how you said that, aren't I? So how to? How do you stop this ship from sailing? How do you stop putting and making more people in it? Have you ever noticed that judgments or accusations spread like cancer? Have you ever noticed that? You'll start off in one area before you know it. You'll start off with your own body and then you start judging everybody else's body. You'll start off with your own looks and then you'll start judging everybody else's look. You'll start off with your own education, your own house you live in. You'll start off there and you'll end up... You know, I reckon I can handle living in Donald Trump's house. Might have $1 million worth of gold in it, but I really don't want the $100 million worth of crap stuff to see. Pull that up. So let's have a look at how to, shall we? First thing I want you to write down, the word acknowledge. Thank you, Aunt Lee. I told you, Aunt Lee, I should have just said stay up there and do the whole message and take the notes. Aunt Lee said it magnificent this morning, acknowledge, write it down. Hardest thing to do is to acknowledge. You know why? Because the moment you give it a bit of your time to acknowledge, you might find yourself in the wrong. How many people love being in the wrong? How many people love being in the right? Now my ship has got a motor. Get a picture of the ship. Now she doesn't need wind anymore. Now she's got plenty of stuff, fuel on her. Now I've got a motor. Horsepower. Oh, there's horsepower, mate. Acknowledgement is the single hardest thing to do. Jesus said, all who call on my name, acknowledge him. That's what he's saying. All who call on my name shall be saved. Saved from what? Thank you very much, Tyson. Saved from myself. So the first thing I've got to acknowledge is myself. Am I? The Bible says, I should have got the scriptures for you, but I didn't. The Bible says, examine your own salvation. Examine your own heart. Yeah? That's what it says. Examine yourself. How are you going with the people around you? How are you going with your loved ones, your work colleagues? How are you going? Are people avoiding you? Are people hanging out with you? Are people able to speak to you freely? You know, one of the things I love about Cheryl and Andrew, and it's taken them a while, so I'm going to hang both of them out to drive off. They're both elders in the church, right? You know how hard it was for them to come and discipline me? When they see me in the wrong, they were even hoping, they were praying that Raph would do it so they didn't have to do it. Do you two remember that? Right? And they were so afraid because how dare he, but I want to show you something. I praise God that they've been able to, because what happens if I'm in the wrong? What happens if I'm in the wrong? What happens if I'm going off on a tangent? What happens if bitterness is starting to grow in me and these two don't do something about it? What damage do you think that can do? Who are you allowing to speak into your life? I won't allow somebody to speak in my life when I see them tearing somebody else's down, because I can't trust them. Cheryl and Andrea, too scared at one point to even, and they were like, when I come out and confess something that I was doing wrong, because Raph rebuked me, they said, oh yeah, we knew that for a while. And I'm like, why didn't you do something about it? Because you're the senior pastor and you're a lot more coming near you. Well, how's that helping everybody else? Now, but see, here's the danger. I've given them an authority to do something. Now, I've said it publicly. That's even worse, Andrew.
Thank
you. You know, my doctor, Krobus, my dearest friend, I love this man with all my heart. There's no point me going to see him in the doctor's surgery and say, I've got something going on. And he goes, well, you need to check. No, I don't. Shut up, will you? I've got to give people the right to speak into my life. Yeah? The question is who? If you isolate yourself, the Bible says keep the company of wise men and women. Allow yourself to be checked. Because if you're not, if you won't allow anybody to check you, if you won't allow anybody to speak in your life, have a look at King David. If you want to see the epitome of a person who judged, this person started off pear-shaped. Go and have a look what he did with Bathsheba. Sleeps, he's up, he's not in the battle where he should have been. All these things he's doing wrong, and it took God to bring a prophet to come along and talk about one sheep and 100 sheep. You want to examine your own heart with the Holy Spirit, and I encourage you to sit there and go, how am I going, Lord? Don't examine somebody else's. Because you know what's going to happen the moment you do. Everybody look at me. When you point your finger, you've got... Oh, and there's the Holy Spirit, because when I was writing this out, I was thinking of people I know, and I started thinking, yeah, this one needs a message, yeah, that one needs a message, that one. Yeah, that's what you do, don't you, Tony? When you're preparing a message, you think it's for everybody else, then you open your mouth, and then you go, oh, we should shut up. Now, by the way, I've got twin outboard turbo motors on now, all right? So the boat's gaining even more power. All right, let's go to the next one. You can't change until you drop your own measure. You cannot change until you drop your own measure. There you go. Whatever you hold on to your measure of judgment, you will not change. You have to drop it from its lofty heights. Okay, so there goes the sails. Just got shot out of my boat. Sails are gone, Cheryl. Big mast is gone. I just got shot out of the boat. You know why? You won't acknowledge where you're going until you acknowledge your own. How many of you know your own flaws, your own faults, your own judgments? You should have a healthy respect for that. We're going to have a look at what happens. Here's what happens when you acknowledge. You can go one of two ways. You can go into conviction or you can go into condemnation. Take your pick. They're both yours. You can acknowledge and say, yes, Lord, or you can acknowledge and say, they're the problem. You can either acknowledge in the affirmative and say, I've got some stuff to fix, or you can acknowledge in denial and say, everybody else is a problem on the planet, not me. It's everybody else's reasons on where I'm at, not mine. My choices have got nothing to do with it. It's all the choices everybody else makes. Denial will lead to condemnation. Do you all know what condemnation looks like in this story? Well, I'm a piece of trash, everybody else must be a piece of trash. Well, I'm ugly, so everybody else must be ugly. My shoe's crap, so your shoes must be crap. My health's crap, so is yours. I don't feel well, so neither are you. I don't dress properly, so how can you? That's what condemnation does. Denial equals condemnation. When you acknowledge in the affirmative, yeah, I've got some things to change, that will equal conviction. What's wrong with me, Lord? Why am I still broken? Why does other people's opinion still stress me out so much? Okay, now one of my turbos is just blowing up in the motor. Because half the problem is I'm not it. Why do people annoy me so much that I'm getting so fired up at them? Okay, there's one motor gone out. Ship's starting to slow down a bit, Tyson. Not revving as hard as it was. Because now I'm starting to have a look at why am I offended? Why am I offended at people? Why do I care what other people wear? Why do I care what your hair looks like? I've got none. How? What does it matter if you've got a mohawk or pink hair? I've got none. Or maybe I'm just not comfortable in my own skin and having no hair. Conviction equals freedom. Condemnation equals bondage and burden. There's your two choices. There is only ever going to be two choices. You can't sit in the middle. You can't half condemn. Well, I suppose you can. You can admit a little bit and deny the rest. I suppose you can. But if you notice, there's not much of a period of time between day and night. You know when the moon and the sun cross over? It's only a little period of time. It's only a little window. It doesn't stay like that for long. It either goes full dark or full light. So you're not going to stay in the middle for long. You're not going to be half-hearted. The Bible says he would rather you be for him or against him than be lukewarm. He would rather you just be full on, because then he can help you. When you stay in the middle, you're stopping him from being able to help you full. There's that one. Okay. What about turn away? Okay. Ship just lost its other motor. Now I'm running out of steam. You know why? Why am I turning away? Why is it annoying me? Why is it offending me so much? Why can't I just turn away? Does it really matter? So why can't I turn away? Here's something you're going to have to deal with. Justice and injustice. Let me show you something. Jesus Christ said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He is the justice. He said, do not get offended or upset when you see the heathens prospering, or you see the unforgiving prospering. I don't get away with anything in this day, either in this life or the next. So why can't we just turn away? Why can't we turn the other cheek? What did he say? When they slap you on the left, turn to the right. Do you know what that means? It doesn't mean turn your cheek to the other side if you get slapped. Let me show you. If they slap you, slides left, this one. If they slap you on the left, turn to the right. Do you know what that actually means? Stop looking at it. Not turn to get slapped again. It's like if I get slapped from there, turn to here. Many of us have to actually turn away. Because the moment we keep looking at it, you're going to start investing in it. It's going to start spreading. It's going to start growing. Okay, so the motor's just sprung a leak. There's both the motors are out. My boat's now stationary. Because all of a sudden the boat's losing its oomph. Because now God's teaching me how to stop judging. Let's have a look at the next one. Oh, here we go. This one nailed me. Pray. Write that one down. You want to know how to get out of these things? Pray. Build a relationship. That's what that means. Instead of farming and harvesting and staying in all of that and becoming an expert of literature, how about you just start praying to the one and only one who can set you free from it? Start talking. Oh, so I started doing that. I started doing that and I noticed the anchor went straight through the bottom of the boat instead of going outside. It started to scuttle me, it started to sink me, because all of a sudden, the more I started praying, the more he started telling me how much these people mean to him. How much I mean to him. How much he doesn't want me living in a... In fact, you know what he said to me? He said, but I don't want you to be a whitewashed tomb. Oh, here we go. He called the Pharisees them. He called the Pharisees that. And I said, what do you mean by whitewashed tomb? And he said, I don't want you to look good on the outside and have all your Christianese language and look good, but on the inside you're a rotten ass. You're a dead man in there. And I said, then how does that work? And he said, when you walk around and in front of your brothers and sisters, oh, you speak nicely. But when you're down the hotel with other people, man, you gossip about everybody, you pull everybody down, you got an opinion on everything under the sun. That's what he means by whitewashed tomb. when you live one way in front of people, and when those people aren't around, then the real you comes out, because the stone rolled away. Oh, now the boat's starting to sink. Now the boat's starting to sink. Everything that I built this boat up to be is now starting to fall apart. And then he says this, what value is your love if you can only pray for those who love you? Even the pagans do that. Even the heathens, you know, the ones that don't belong to him? So if we can't pray for those who oppress us, those who attack us, then what good's our prayer life? Found myself praying for a few people that I'd probably rather a brick fell on their head, but I found myself last night actually praying for a few people. Yeah, because I didn't realise until I started examining through this message, I started looking at my own life and I started going, oh, oh wow. I started praying for a few people. Some people that really ticked me off in recent months. Last night were getting my full attention in prayer, Lord. This was my prayer, if you want to know. Father, bless them. Because they know not what they do. They don't understand what they're doing. But Lord, I'm mature enough to know what I'm doing. Forgive me. So there's your prayer. I wrote it here, big capital letters next to prayer. What comes with repair? I just said, Father, forgive me for what I've been doing. Repent. You want to get out of it? Acknowledge it and repent it. And if you know you've been judging, and you'll know, just by the way I'm talking, you'll know. Because when Han Lee started talking, I went, oh, there's that boat getting... Han Lee was talking and the boat was trying to come back, like the Titanic back up again. It's like, no, you're staying sunk. Repent. Which means what? Change your way of thinking.
Amen.
There you go. If you know you're catching up and with the mothers, or the mother's meeting, or you know you're catching up with a few people and all they do is bag everybody, stop going to the meeting. You're going to hang out with people that can't find nothing good to say, then don't be near them. Until you're able, I want you to hear this, I'm not telling you to leave people, until you're able to say it, stand there and say, you know, I can't be part of this. Can we change topic? You know, can we pray for them? Can we bless them? Can we send them a bunch of flowers? Can we do something? Next one. Damn. Boat's nearly sunk now, Tyson. It's nearly sunk. We've got the flag on the end just hanging there. You know my rights. It's sort of going down now, like the Titanic. Read your Bible. Let me show you one thing that I've worked out. Whenever I've got the proverbial on the liver, my time with God in reading goes out the window. Classic evidence for me. Read your Bible. Here's the hard part. If you're like me and you don't want to acknowledge it, you don't want to admit that you're in the wrong, you won't read your Bible because you don't want to be convicted by the Word. Read the Bible and learn how our Lord and Savior dealt with things. Learn what He did. He's supposed to be our measuring stick. We're supposed to measure against Him. Read your Bible. I want to extend that for a minute. If I can. Oh no, that's on the next one. Reading the Bible means taking time for your Lord. It means you've actually got to say, Lord, I'm not going to sit in this judgment because I want to read about you. I'm going to hand them over. Boat's nearly gone, Tyson, I tell you. Mate, my whole boat, my whole defence is nearly blown out of the water now. All we're doing is got the little back of the boat. It's the only bit that's still floating. It's the back of the boat. Because everything's being sunk. You know why Jesus said, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you can speak to this mountain and you can command it to go into the sea, be submerged. Have you noticed I'm now speaking to the mountains in my life? One of the mountains is judgment. Have you noticed? I'm telling you, the boat's starting to submerge. It's nearly gone. Oof, and she was the size of the Titanic, mate. She was the size of the Titanic and it started off as a canoe. That's how big this boat grew with me doing this message. Size of the Titanic, bloody it's made out of wood. Last one, we're going to finish on this one. What about fellowship? Here you go. Han Lee, magnificent. We're supposed to mourn when one mourns. We're supposed to rejoice when one rejoices. Can I show you something? Do you know why iron sharpens iron? You ever bothered to ask God about that? I did last night because I knew I was speaking on this and we did on Wednesday. We touched on it a little bit. Let me show you. Iron banging each other creates a spark. that in the right conditions will light a fire. Let me show you something. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. We should be ironing, hitting, sparking to set fire to each other and burn up some of these things that are not of God by being with each other, by caring for each other. One of the things that we have to learn as a people, we have to learn that you should be able to speak to anybody in here and feel safe enough that whatever you say be trusted and not used against you. Let me show you something. You want to have a really good look at where you're going? How many people in here do you trust to speak your heart to? That should give you a very good look at where you're really at. And if there's people in here that you wouldn't speak to, why don't you go and talk to God about your reasons why you won't? There you go. Because fellowship, he put a huge price on. You all know the scripture, so I'm going to quote it. Do not neglect the what? Gathering of the brethren. There's safety in numbers. There's safety in family. Go and have a look at children that have been orphaned. And what's the hardest thing to get them through is to belong to another family. All of you have been orphans at one time or another. You've been in the world. Getting you to fit in and to be part of a family. You know, personal grief, personal beef, am I allowed to say that? You know, I don't understand, you know, I love our church, right? And our church is free because we want it to be free. But I cannot understand how we've got a different crowd of people every week. I've got to be here because I've got to be with you. Even if I go to the Kangaroo Island, I've still got to be at church. I know we're all busy, I know we all do everything, but the fellowship, you know, that's why we put such a high focus on lunch. Not just so we can feed you, because we heard that earlier. Why do we all come to church? For lunch. Heard that, I was outside, but I heard you lot. My boat got bigger when I heard that. I want to encourage us because we get to do this. We get to sit and talk and yarn, ask each other about how's your family's going, what's going on, who's happening, who's doing. Anyway, we'll leave that alone. In finishing this, there's three other things that come that I want to put, so write them down. Here they are. The first one is correction also comes in fellowship. There's safety in being corrected. What if you're going off with a tangent? What happens if you're off with the fairies on something? What happens if you make up the rules in your own head and say, it's okay for me to judge? I'm allowed to do that. And I've got something for you. Don't come and reach to me when other people are judging you back and your life's suddenly awfully alone. Because that's what's coming too. You'll know things aren't right when nobody comes near you. Why don't you go and ask God why? Your BO might be bad, your footy shorts might not be right. Correction, what about learning? Write that one down. Fellowship is about learning. Bible study is about learning. Learning the Word of God. And the Word of God will do correction on its own. Now, I really need Cheryl to come along and knock you out. You just need to read the Word and it'll correct you. Last one. Probably the greatest gift in the church that I think is missing. Of all the power gifts, this is the greatest of all of them. And it's a gift of encouragement. Good to see you here. Blessed to have you here. God's got a hope and a future for you. Encouraging one another. Because if you can't, you know, you can only give out what you receive. Yeah, so who in here's got $1 million? Oh, they made, okay, let's make it 100 million. Just sucks out of everybody's reach. Who in here's got $100 million? Can I have it, please? Who in here's got the elixir to health? You know that you can drink and you never get sick. Who's got that? None of you. You cannot give me what you do not have yourself. Try to remember that. Try to remember you can only give out what you first received yourself. So, have you received your first love? Have you received the fullness of the love of Jesus Christ for who you are? Have you received the fullness of the forgiveness of your sin, no matter how great or small, no matter how big, no matter what? Have you received that? Until you can receive the fullness of the grace of Jesus Christ and what he paid for you. This is where I found myself last night. I found myself weeping. A couple of tears coming out. Do you know why? Because while I was sitting there building this yacht, it turned into the Titanic, guys. While I was building it, You know what he kept reminding me? He kept reminding me that what he sunk when I came into him was far bigger than I've ever built. I actually thought the Titanic was big until he showed me that, what I'd actually built was an aircraft carrier. And I actually had things landing off and on at 100 mile an hour, and he said to me, an aircraft carrier was a bit bigger than the Titanic. And I said to him, what do you mean? He goes, you remember I sunk your aircraft carrier and all the planes on it? All the bitternesses, all the judgments, all the spite, I sunk it for you. So I'm going to say this to you all. I praise God for Jesus Christ. I praise God for grace. I praise God for his righteousness, that I am in right standing with Father God because of Christ, my Lord. I praise God that not only did he go to the cross, he got off the cross. I praise God that not only did he go into a tomb, he came out of the tomb. So I could come out of the tomb. So I'm going to get you all just to bow your heads for a minute. Oh, no, one more. You can all open your eyes. One more. Here's a good one. It's something that was told to me. I was having a time in my life where it just felt like everybody was against me. Just felt like everybody had a comment, everybody was judging, everybody was having an opinion on everything. And I remember speaking to this person, and I said to this person, I can't take it anymore. And I know that every place I go, every conversation, wherever there are Christians, it just keeps popping up. And it doesn't matter what I do, I'm already offended before I even get there. And do you know what he said to me? I'm going to read it, please. Never forgotten it today, I want you to write it down. And it says, purpose your heart to not be offended, and you won't get hurt. There you go. Purpose your heart to not be offended, and you won't get hurt. I have tried that, and believe me, it works, but it requires a bit of self-discipline. It requires a bit of self-sacrifice. It requires Christ to remain my Lord and Savior for this to work. Because the moment I petition myself to be offended, you know how easy that is? Let me show you. This is how you petition yourself to be offended when I catch up with that idiot. That's simple. Oh, don't want to bump into that person again, sick of seeing them. You're already offended before you see them. But imagine being able to twist it and say, you know what, Lord, if I bump into them today, give me a heart as soft as a dove, but a skin, my emotions as thick as a rhinoceros' skin, so their words don't barb me. Imagine what a bit of prayer could do. Interesting. All right, now you can close your eyes. We'll see if I think of something else, Andrew. If the message is spoken to you, and you'll know if it has, simple as that, you'll know where you are with the Lord. The first question I've got, how are you going with your first love? That's my first question. Your first love is not the first girl you started dating behind the rainwater tank at school. Your first love is Jesus Christ. How are you going with him? That's all you've got to answer. How are you going with Jesus Christ, your Lord and Saviour? Are you forgetting your first love? Are you walking in your first love? Have you embraced his love yet? There's something for you. Simple, simple question I'm going to ask. If he's not your first love, if you've lost your first love, all you do is put your hand up. So what are you going to do? And then look at me when you put your hand up so you don't have to hold it up forever. Thank you. Anyone else? Jesus just wants to set you free. He just wants to reinstate your first love. You can have a number of reasons for where you are physically, where you are mentally, where you are spiritually. Very relevant to him. Because he wipes them off in a second. In a millisecond. So anybody else? No one. I believe there's more in here. Do you know why? Because last night I put my own hand up. There you go. Most of you won't know that. Yep. Last night I put my own hand up because when I went through this message for you, that's why I'm trying to explain it. Look at the boat that I built to set sail in. It was when the love of God came on. Yep, gotcha, bro. It's when the love of God came on, yep, and the anchor went through the bottom of the boat that the boat started to sink, like he took the bottom out. There's a few hands going up. Yep. First love. And all he wants to do You know the single thing that he does better than anybody else, or better than anything on this planet when it comes to judgment? Not only does he wipe it away, but he restores you to authenticity. He restores you to being authentic, not being fake. You know, trying to fake it till you make it. I'm just trying to be nice. You know, with deep in heart, you can't stand that person, but you fake it anyway. Nah, he restores you to authenticity. Anybody else? Those of you that put your hand up once you come out the front. Normally I would tell you you don't have to, but today you do. Today you do. Today you can stand up and come out the front because God's going to meet you. When I said to him, do you want me to preach on this? And he said to me, you watch what I'm going to do. Is I'm going to sink some boats, calm some waters, flood some hearts, open some minds. He said, I'm going to do what nobody else in this universe can do. Only I can. Well, that's pretty cool to know that only he can, isn't it, James? Might kick to do that, I reckon. Don't worry, I haven't finished the ministry. This is his first part of it. Is there all of you? Oh, there is too. Oh, you've lined up too. Look at you go. Don't worry. I did this last night, so don't think this is all about... Yeah, you can all come forward a bit, please, otherwise you're going to end up hurting yourselves. I had to do this myself last night. I had to sit there and actually say to the Lord, I need my love back, your love back. I need you to be first and foremost in my life. So all of you, before I anoint you, and it's going to be as simple as me anointing. I'm not going to stand there and pray for you for 3 hours. We're just going to see what God wants to do. Because if he does what he promised me he's going to do, you're going to be new creations. All of you out the front are just going to simply look at me for a minute. You acknowledge you need him, yeah? You acknowledge that you're empty without him. And you acknowledge that you need him to fill you with love again today. Everyone acknowledges that? And that's all you need to do. Can you come around? Maybe some chairs. We might need some chairs, I reckon. Maybe. We'll see how we go. See if people jump. we'll see how we go. Just catch them. We're not going to let you spoil the life. But you watch what God's going to do to us. That's my anointing through the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I said, we release the power of God. Love him, Lord. I'm going to use you again. That's simple. That's pretty cool, isn't it? Good catch there. You ready? You're still doing your job, are you? How about you just let me look? And I am going to, hey, by the way, you can all look. I am going to touch you, is that okay? Rather than asking you all individually. How are you, welcome. Shall I anoint your name in the Father? The Son. Oh, there you go. There you go. Just let the love come on you. Yeah? There you go. Hey? How cool is that? Where are you, Andrew? I'm running with you with your. Oh, how cool is that, Shell? Hallelujah. First love. The greatest love of all, isn't it, Tracy? First love. The love of a Saviour on his children, yeah? Tracy, I anoint your name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Fall on the Lord. Now, there you go. Oh, there you go. That's yours too. Hallelujah. Just let him love you. That's all you have to do. Whatever that looks like, you just let him love you. Grab your chair for that one, Andrew. Oh, I'll stay with you. Ah, just let him love. Thank you, Lord. You all guys there, Andrew, are you? Come on, Janelle, here we go. It's a pretty cool saviour, isn't it? Janelle, I anoint you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It's free.